Oh, that's funny. I know who doesn't want me to call on him this afternoon, so that worked very well. I was talking about my son this morning, so many of you now have seen him. He walked in. So this is my youngest son, Brady, right here. You know, many of you look at your own lives and you say to yourself, my life's just not going very good. But I would ask you to consider my son, because he's got me as a dad. And how much difficulty that must be for him. And I remember back, if I can tell one quick story, he was 12 years old. He was playing baseball. We lived in Salt Lake at the time. I was the HR manager for the Chevron refinery down in North Salt Lake. And I used to ride my bicycle from Brighton High School area down to the Salt Lake refinery. One day, I had done that, and I was riding home to coach his baseball team. He was a 12-year-old playing Little League baseball. And as I rode up on my bicycle for the game, if you can picture this, it was a hot summer day. I didn't have my shirt on. I was sweating all over the place, probably had slobber all over my mouth. And I heard a couple of Brady's friends say, "Hey, Brady, there's your dad." He looked over at me and goes, "That's not my dad." So his whole life, he's had to kind of play with, "That's not my dad." But he's done a good job of adjusting. His number one strength is adaptability. Wu is number two. So, again, I think he's had to adapt to the fact that I'm his dad, and I appreciate him doing that. All right, so this afternoon, for those of you that weren't here this morning, we're going to talk about effective leadership of change. We'll tie in some of the concepts that we met or talked about this morning. I don't think it'll be very repetitive, but you might hear some of the same terms or same of the thought processes that we talked about this morning. To get started, I'd like each of you to do this for me. I'd like you to close your eyes, and I'd like you to think for just a moment or two about 5 years from today. So today is what? June 19th, 2013. If each of you would close your eyes and think about 2018, June 19th, 2018, and think about what your life is going to look like, both from a personal standpoint as well as a work standpoint. Think about some of the things that you might be involved with. Think about some of the things that you might be dealing with 5 years from today that maybe you're not dealing with today. So if you'll close your eyes, think about that, and we'll talk a little bit about that here in just a moment. All right, open your eyes. Normally my son and I have a gig where he steals all the purses and wallets during that time period. But I told him at lunch, it's a pretty good group and they don't have much money anyway, so let's just stay focused on the task at hand. So check that if you're worried about that. But 5 years from today, 2018, start sharing with me some of the things that might be different, and we don't need to share about your personal, although I think it's good for you to go there as well. But think about some of the things that might be different in your job, in the library system. Tell me about what some of those changes might be. You heard some of them maybe this morning and some of the presenters, but what's your interpretation of what some of those changes might be? Anybody? More technology, that's a fact. I can't imagine what flip charts will look like in 5 years. I'm excited to see that. I'm going to be able to just kind of wrinkle my nose and that thing's going to get posted by itself or something. It's going to be cool. What else? What else is going to be there 5 years from today? Aaron, what's something that's going to be there from your perspective? That maybe not there right now. I always do that. I wait till you put something in your mouth. Marissa, what's something that might be different?
I think something I know I need to learn about
Okay. So there's going to be a need for additional education. Your skill set today might not be acceptable 5 years from today. Fair? Please, Cheryl.
Well, I'm on the verge of retiring.
Okay.
So 5 years, hopefully, I won't be working in the field. But what I see is people from my generation are going, a lot of us are starting this wave of retirements, and you're going to get a new crop of people coming through that have been with technology from the very get-go.
Okay.
From the time they were children.
Correct.
So I think we're going to see a real big mindset change.
Ah, good. I like that. I think you're absolutely right. So I think what Cheryl's saying, hang on, I'll come right back. I think patron expectations are going to be different in 5 years than they are today. And if you don't think so, you're kidding yourself. They are going to be different. Jim.
Well, kind of just what we're doing with iLead, I can see in my own job moving from creating finding aids to a more collaborative and innovative approach.
All right. Okay, good. Yeah, good. My son just got done, I'll be right back to you. My son just got done with his MBA at Arizona State. Every single class he took, every single class was a collaborative effort. You no longer get an MBA without the opportunity or the ability to work with other people. Those days are gone. Collaboration is going to be key. And for those of you that are thinking about, boy, do I love my little corner where I don't have to interact with anybody, be thinking about that, because it's coming. Erin.
I know this for sure in Salt Lake City, but it's a national trend, so it should be the case for everyone, is the people that we serve will be very different. We'll have a much
better base. All right. Yeah. There are going to be old people like me with long hair. That's pretty diverse. You're going to have to deal with weird guys like me. What else? What else is going to be different? What else did you think about during those 5 years? Lindy, what did you think about? What's it going to be like?
Well, I actually thought I'm a children's librarian.
Okay.
So I just thought kids are going to be so inundated with technology that we're going to be super creative.
All right. You know what the libraries are going to have to be like? They're going to have to be like the zoo or the circus. If you don't entertain them, they ain't coming. Because they got lots of other choices to get the same services you're providing. So the question is, are you going to be able to play in the entertainment world? Because that might be what it's going to take. Don't know, right? We don't know. All I know is 5 years ago versus today, I wouldn't pretend that I could have anticipated what's going on today. Five more years, kind of scary. Dustin, what's it going to be like for you 5 years from now?
You know, honestly, I always laugh at this question because I'm where I live is at least 15 years behind here. So.
I lived in Bountiful once, too.
Technologies that are taking over, and I was at a school board meeting, and they were talking about the number of homes on the Navajo reservation that still don't have electricity. I was like, ooh. I was like, hey,
yep.
My job's safe for a long time. You all gotta recognize, I'm fine.
You know, it's funny, the mindset is it's just old guys like me that have trouble with change. My experience is change has nothing to do with age. One's ability to change has nothing to do with age.
I like what she was saying about, like, you know, they're going to be so connected. And I just leaned over to Tegan and said, then why don't we make a space at the library where people actually disconnect? And take that into our future. The fact of the matter is we can shape that. And like right now we're all about getting everyone connected, but we can create a floor where people just disconnect.
Interesting. a place to disconnect. That's pretty creative.
We're hyper-connected.
Yeah, pretty creative. Worse. You might be onto something.
Can't wait to get my Google Glass.
Might be onto something.
My son has some. They're awesome.
We do background checks all
yeah.
Anybody else want to share with what they saw 5 years from now? What did you see?
So this is kind of along with the additional education, but already we're seeing people coming in with more in-depth questions.
Okay. I think you're absolutely right. It's amazing to see the kinds of questions that are coming up from our kids, from our peers. They are so much more articulate. They are so much more in depth. And again, we can't wiggle our way out of some of those tough questions that we're going to be facing in the next 5 years. It can be scary. It's a little scary. Anybody else, please? Okay. Yeah. 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 I wish Britton were here and you can ask her, because she and I have had this conversation. It's the only time I've ever seen her throw a Webster's old dictionary at me, and she threw it hard. Because in one of these sessions that I did in Southern Utah, I said, although the reference was 10 years rather than 5, I said, in 10 years, there will not be a library book in any library facility. Now, here she walks. You can ask her. She is so mad at me, she's barely now talking to me, because she says, Dennis, people always want to have a relationship with a book. And I'm going, I don't know if that's true or not. I think what they want to have a relationship with is entertainment and searching and all kinds of other stuff. And it may or may not be with a book. Now, again, we don't have time to debate that. She'll give you one side, I'll give you the other side. But the fact of the matter is, and I think we all can agree with this, there's going to be one word, and one word very clearly, that we're all going to have to face in the next 5 years. And what is that word? Yeah, good. That's not such a rocket science to put that down, but it certainly is. No matter what your vision was for 5 years from now, things are going to be a little different than they were 5 years ago. All right. So I'm curious, and we'll get to the PowerPoint, because I know most of you are saying, gosh, doesn't this guy ever use PowerPoint or something a little more technologically advanced? I will in just a moment. What are some different ways that you've seen leaders lead change, either good or bad? What are some different strategies you've seen people lead change efforts? Anybody? Dixon, what's one strategy? You've been around a long time. What's a way you've seen people lead change, good or bad? Have you ever seen somebody lead change by saying, it's my way? She even got the second part right, or the highway. My way. Wouldn't you all agree that that is one approach for leading change? This is my way. I would strongly encourage you to get on board. Or don't let the door hit you on the way out. Now, again, we're more sophisticated than that, but we still see a lot of that. What's another way of leading change? Please.
Consensus building.
All right, good. I like that one a lot. You weren't even here this morning. You did good. Yeah, being able to get members from different audiences and get them on board and see if we can work together to figure out where it is we want to go and how we want to get there. Consensus building. What's another way? Bond. Jim was saying, hey, you have the answer.
I don't know. I guess you have to be enthusiastic.
All right, good. So another way for leading change is enthusiasm. Wouldn't you agree it's a little easier to get behind somebody who's got a little of enthusiasm about where it is we're going and why? Isn't that a strategy for leading change? It is. What else? Please. All right. Collaboration, cross-training. What's the number one reason why people are afraid of change in the workplace? The number one reason? They're going to lose their job. I won't have something to do to bring money home to my family. Number one reason why people are afraid of change. Please.
That's why you throw the money at them and say, here's your incentive.
Ah, that always comes out. Bribe them. We'll bribe them to change. I got some bad news from you. If you work in the Utah library system, they ain't going there. There's a lot of strategies that are going to happen. That's not one. Where he works, that might happen. Not where you work. Any other ways for leading change? Please.
Making it safe to fail.
All right. I like that one real well. Make it safe to fail. When I played college basketball, I played for a coach that every single time I made a mistake, I knew exactly what was going to happen. We used to call it the cane, and the cane would put us on the bench pretty quickly. How apt was I to be creative in that kind of environment? I wasn't too apt because I didn't want to have a sore neck. So I played as conservatively as I could so I didn't get taken out. What a crummy way to play the game of basketball. What a crummy way to live your life in the workplace when all you got to do is be so conservative, nobody notices who you are. That's a crummy way to go through the next 30 years. Don't do it. Create an environment where it's safe to fail. That is a great strategy for leading change. Anybody else? Please. Ah, good.
It's a little bit about collaboration, but you know, bringing in other viewpoints into your library and exposing your people to them.
I love that idea, because again, what happens with some of us as leaders of change is the more information I have, the less you have, the better off I am. I'm going to do everything I can to make sure I got all the information. That's another way to lead change, but it's not too good a one. Erin, please.
Well, as part of that, I think making sure your people are as informed about the processes as possible.
Yeah.
As things come up, they don't feel like they don't know what happened.
Yeah, involve your people, please. Marissa.
And I think part of it's framing it in the proper context. But I know in our organization, since we're so large, sometimes the question is not, this is a decision that we're making at this level, and we appreciate input, but we're not going to collaborate. So sort of defining how the decisions for the change are going to be made.
All right, good. I think that's wonderful. Isn't that a great way to lead change, is establish boundaries and follow them? Because there's nothing worse than say your input counts and know darn well it ain't going to count. I hate that. Just tell me up front it ain't going to count. I'm okay with that. I'm a good soldier. Don't tell me something and then lead it a different way. Jim.
I think number one thing is before you start leading the change, is change yourself.
All right.
And also, good. Believe that change is needed.
Britt, just so you know, I told him to answer that way at lunch, so he would look good in front of you, because he said that's important for him. And I said, Britt, or I said, Jim, this is going to be a way for you to look really good in front of your boss. Here's what you need to say. He did that well. And with that, we'll move to the next point, because Jim's point's exactly right. Here is what I believe are two different ways to lead change. Number one way to lead change is to be a positive living example for that change. And I would suggest the other extreme as far as how to lead change would be the approach of no way. Every time something comes up in some way, shape, or form, you say to yourself or everybody around you, no way is that going to happen. So those are two extremes for leading change. Let's develop them just a moment. So if you're going to be a positive living example for change, what are some of the things you got to do as a leader? If you're going to be a positive living example, what are you going to do? Jim, what did you just say? Yeah, believe it myself. I'm going to believe it myself. So if you want to be a positive living example for change, you better darn well believe it yourself. And if not, you better figure out why and do something about it. What else does being a positive living example for change? What are some of the other attributes of a leader that's going to be a positive living example? Britton?
Listen to other people's ideas.
Okay, again, listen. Love it. What else? Please.
Encourage.
Keep going. What else?
Motivate.
What else?
Provide a vision.
All right. Provide vision.
Get engaged.
Get engaged?
No, be engaged.
Oh, be engaged? Be engaged. That's what I was going to say. Matt.
Try to see yourself through other people's eyes.
Ah, good. Wow. I love that one. Matt was paying attention this morning. Cool. Please.
Be transparent.
All right. Funny, whenever I hear that word, I think people are going to see right through me. I don't get that, but I always write it down because it sounds good. Transparency, absolutely. What else?
Admit mistakes.
Ah, I love it. Yeah, back to the basketball analogy. I'd get pulled out of the game and my coach would say, or I'd say, hey, that was a bad pass, I know. And he goes, yeah, and you're not getting back in the game either.
Take risks.
Take risks. Good. So here's the point. 5 years from now, each of you had a vision in your own mind about what things are going to be as opposed to where they are today. And the question for you is, how are you going to get from here to there? And one opportunity might be to be a positive living example as described on that flip chart. Let's go to the other way. This one might not be quite so... This one might not be quite so positive, but has anybody ever seen anybody lead change with the attitude of no way? What are things people do as leaders to say no way? Because nobody's that stupid to say no way in front of everybody else, but what are other things they can do to say no way? Ah, good, absolutely. They don't remove them. They create them. Good. What else?
Poor communication.
Poor communication. I love it. I know where we're going and why we're going there, but I'll be darned if I'm going to tell you. I'd rather keep you in the dark. Colleen.
Make everybody else take the risk.
Ah. Everyone else takes risk. As you whisper in their ear at lunchtime, why don't you go do this, this, and this and see what happens? And the whole time you're going, I can't wait to watch this. This is going to be funny. This is going to be funny.
Let it. All you have to do is take the previous list and do six, you know.
Maybe, huh? Yeah, maybe. Yeah, so again, here's the bottom line as we move into the PowerPoint. No matter what anybody says, where you are today and where you're going to be 5 years from now as a leader, it's your choice. I don't care what your boss does. I don't care what the organization does. I don't care about any of those things. It's still your choice on how you're going to lead change. And it's coming. So let's play with this PowerPoint. Let's see if we can develop some of these things at a little higher level. I'm so excited to get rid of those flip charts. Okay, leadership of change. Change is everywhere. It's not going away. So how many of you don't supervise people right now? How many of you don't have any people you supervise? Quite a few of you, right? So you might be saying to yourself, this has nothing to do with me. I don't supervise people. And my strong suggestion to everyone in this room, as I said this morning, is that's not true. Every single one of you in this room have the capability, have the ability to lead change. We talked about this morning. What is leadership? It's one's ability to inspire, influence, serve others so that they might do better than they would on their own. Leadership is helping other people do better than they would on their own. If you can inspire them to do better on their own, if you can influence them to do better on their own, if you can serve them in a way so that they do better than they would on their own, that's what leadership is. And again, each one of you have that capability of doing so. I was driving in the airport out of the airport, and I can't remember what state I was in, but I heard this over the radio. The average person influences 10,000 people in their lifetime. The average person influences 10,000 people in their lifetime. Now, where Jim and Dixon are, that means they got to influence everybody in the whole county. And that may or may not be happening. But the fact of the matter is, every time you have some kind of exposure to anybody, whether it's in the grocery store, your kid after school, or people you interact with, you have the ability to influence them. How many of you saw the movie 42 with Jackie Robinson? Did anybody see that movie? You need to see the movie. And the reason you need to see the movie is for one distinct part of the movie. This young kid goes to his first baseball game in Cincinnati. First baseball game he's ever been to. He is the happiest kid he's ever seen. He is so happy to be at the ballpark. He walks into the ballpark, and he's looking around, and this is cool, this is great. And then Jackie Robinson walks out on the field, and all these adults around him start yelling the N-word at Jackie Robinson. And this little kid's kind of looking, and he's going, what's going on around here? I don't get this. Guess what he does 10 minutes later? He yells out the N-word to Jackie Robinson. If you don't think for one moment that those adults around this young kid influenced Jack or this young kid, you're wrong. You influence 10,000 people in your lifetime. How are you doing on that? How are people looking at you, and what kind of influence are you on them? It's kind of a humbling question if you ask me. It's a pretty humbling question about what people see with you when they look at you and your leadership. We talked this morning about serving. Here's some of the definitions. We brought many of those this morning. I think that list is certainly relevant. Again, if you're going to serve others, you've got to be able to do these things. And I said this morning, all of your jobs should be doing those sort of things. For those of you that joined us this afternoon, I think the same with you. Your job is to do what's on that board. And if you're getting paid for something that's on that board, shame on the library system. Shame on you for not doing these things, because that's what you ought to be getting paid for. I love this quote. I love this quote. Because so many of us as leaders go, this is cool. Now you can watch me in action, and it's impressive. And you go home at the end of the day, and you're talking to whoever you talk to, and you're saying, I did this, I did that, and boy, was I impressive. And the fact of the matter is, you got it backwards. You got it backwards. Because the best leaders I ever worked for, the best leaders I ever worked with, they did an amazing job of showing me how amazing I was. It was never about them. It was always about us. And it's a real art. You got to work at that one, because our natural tendency is to make it all about you, make it all about me, and that will catch up with you. For those of you that are in senior management positions here, you know, I think it's important to recognize that one-third of the bottom line profitability, and again, I know we have a tough time measuring profitability in sections like libraries, but one-third of it is tied to how well, what's going on with your people. That's a pretty big number, by the way. That's a pretty big number. You can have all the technology in the world. You can have all the best books in the world. You can have all those wonderful things. But if you haven't created a culture, if you haven't created a climate, you're missing out on about one-third of where you could be. And that's a lot. That's a big number. Don't kid yourself otherwise. Just a fun comparison. What kind of leader are you? Are you of one that's always comparing, always competing, always criticizing? Are you a leader that's always accepting, always acknowledging, always appreciating? And I love what somebody said about, can we learn to see how other people see us? Because I know right now every one of you are saying, well, I'm absolutely a C3 leader. If you don't believe me, just ask me. And who really do I need to ask if I want to know what's really going on? Who should I ask? Everybody else, right? Everybody else is who I ought to be asking. Not you, but everybody else. All right, here's what I believe. You don't have to agree with this, but here's what I believe. I think in our lifetime, from this second forward, there's only four things that will remain status quo. Only four things. I think there will continue to be 60 minutes in every hour. I believe there will continue to be 24 hours in every day. I believe there will continue to be 7 days in every week. And I also believe there will continue to be 365 days in the year. Nothing else is going to stay the same. Nothing else is going to stay the same. That's the only thing. Get comfort in those four. If you're a person that doesn't like change, feel good about those four, because they're not changing. The bad news is people's expectations are going to change. You're going to have different expectations of yourself. your boss is going to continue to have different expectations of you. Your peers, the people you work with, will continue to have different expectations of you. Your employees, for those that are supervisors, will continue to have different expectations. Your environment, your customers. In other words, just about everything else. So again, 5 years from now, there's going to be something going on in your life that's different than today. You got a couple of different ways to choose on how to lead that. I'm going to be a positive living example to do it, or I'm going to be a no way kind of individual. Those things aren't changing, or those things will continue to change. All right, everywhere, it's not going away. Is it time to maybe do something positive about it? That's why I was invited here. Colleen said, Dennis, can you come up and spend a little bit of time with our leaders and give us some tools to help us lead change? Because we know it's inevitable. We know it's coming. So how do you lead change? Again, for those that were here this morning, those of you that have taken the strength profile, you recognize that there are one of four categories that your leadership falls into, or at least is highlighted by one, maybe two of those categories: executor, relationship builder, strategic thinker, or the ability to influence others. With each one of those strengths, which is what you see and know about yourself, you have what's called blind spots. And just so you know, spell check always tells me blind spots is incorrect. But I'm still going to spell it that way no matter what. It is my inability to change that's going to cause me to keep doing that. No way. What others see, know about me. Your strengths versus your blind spots. We all have them. We all have to deal with them. I use the analogy of a bicycle. It'd be the same thing as a motorcycle. We all know that area, what's protected or unprotected from a mirror standpoint. And again, sometimes it's what those blind spots cause you to hurt yourself or hurt those around you. So let's talk about these. Let's assume for a moment that you're an executor. What's your natural tendency for leading change if you're an executor? For those that were here this morning, what's the natural way you're going to lead change if you're an executor? I'm going to jump in and I'm going to get it done. And if you thought I was an executor before change, wait till you see me with change. I'm going to jump in there and really go for it. Because an executor gets things done. They got high results, high energy. You're a self-starter. You provide your own power supply. Yesterday's over. Not afraid to get involved. Give it to me. I'll get it done. I'm sure most of you are saying, that sounds exactly like me. Dennis, how did you know me? You didn't. You just met me this morning. That's exactly how I am. And again, when you're leading change, my suggestion is, if you think you did that before, during times or periods where there wasn't a change, when change is going on, you're going to be doing those at a much higher level. Instead of working 50 hours a week, you're going to be clocking in 60. Instead of getting 40 things done, you're going to be getting 50. Because that's what an executor does during periods of change. Doesn't sound all that bad. But there's this thing called blind spots. So the blind spots for an executor is, as we talked about this morning, I versus we. An executor tends to get it, I got to do this. I got to go there. I got to make that happen. I. So here's what's scary. If you're an executor and you're leading change, if we said all those things on the left side get better, what happens to the blind spots? during periods of change? Cheryl? Yeah, and maybe instead of three eyes, there's five eyes. So all those things that are on that list right now from a blind spot standpoint, my suggestion to you as you decide, do I want to be a positive living example or do I want to be a no way? And if you want to be a no way person in leading change, do everything yourself. Go do everything yourself and see how effective you are in leading change. You have just said no way in a different kind of way. But the problem is just as serious. It's just as serious. So now most of you are going, well, I'm not an executor. I thought I was a minute ago, but I'm not one of those. I can't wait to see what the other ones are because they got to be better than that one. So let's explore those other three because that's what an executor is. Many of you in this room are an executor. All right, what if you're a strategic thinker like me? Gosh, get the big picture, long-range thinker, know where I'm going, know how to get there. I'm a visionary, got great plans, great ideas. The future is a real opportunity. People like me, we love change. We love change. Where it is and how to get there. Now some of you are going, well, I'm a strategic thinker. I thought I was an executor, but I'm a strategic thinker. I was wrong there for a minute, but now I got it right. Because we all want to be those, right? Those are good ones. But the blind spots, as we described this morning, some of the devil is in the details. Today's important too. Details can haunt you. Have I truly engaged others? Do others know when, where, and why? I am the most famous for doing just this. I know where it is, I want to go, and I know how to get there. And it is so perfectly clear to me, I am just so excited to get there. But what happens when I turn around? There is nobody there. There is nobody there. They are scattered all over the place, from here to Timbuktu. Because though, even though it was obvious to me, and I knew where I wanted to go, as a leader, I need to do a better job of engaging others. And when you're leading change, can you see where strategic thinking, if you're not careful, some of those blind spots will haunt you from here to Timbuktu. If I assume everybody knows where we're going and why, and I'm wrong, people will be scattered all over the place, and it will not be pretty. All right. You're running out of choices. You're going, oh, yeah, I must be a relationship builder. There's nothing wrong with being a relationship builder. I mean, just by the terms itself, that's a good thing. Yeah, relationships are key to success. You know how to make trust-based relationships. They're sincere, they're genuine, they're caring. You're just a good person. How many of you like it when somebody says, well, Jim's just a good old guy? He likes to hear that. We all like to hear we're just a good old guy or gal. We like to hear that. Willingness to compromise, seek consensus, avoid conflict. All right, Dennis, yeah, I'm pretty sure I'm a relationship builder. Those are good ones. I'm a good guy. What happens during periods of change if you're strong in relationship building? And people come up to you and they're kind of whining about some of the changes and they're making you feel kind of bad for leading some of those changes. What's your tendency? Cave in might be one. What else? Yeah. Yeah, what took 1 year is now a 3-year project. because the relationships are oftentimes more important than where we're going. And some of you are saying to yourself right now, man, I hate conflict. I hate it. I would rather do anything than avoid conflict or to get involved with conflict. And I got some bad news for you. Whenever you're going from here to there over the next 5 years, bad news, there's going to be conflict. Relationship building. Some of the blind spots associated with being a relationship builder. I can pick on my son because he's not here. He will talk to you for the next 2 days about how great it's going to be to go where we're going. He has no clue what he's saying most of the time, but I tell you what, it sounds exciting. Can't wait to get there with him. He is extremely good at getting people excited, motivated about where we're trying to go. You want to buy in and you want to go there. It sounds fun. Might be St. George in July, but it sounds like fun. I like hearing what you have to say. You're entertaining. You've got a good message. People will follow you. Everybody has a potential relationship with you. But I tell you what, if you're going to lead change from here to where you want to go, and people view you a little bit like a used car salesperson, they'll follow you for a little ways, but then pretty soon they're going to say to themselves, I'm not going with him. That guy didn't have a clue what he's doing. Do you really listen? Do you move on too quickly with relationships? Are you a producer or are you just a good talker? And again, each one of those things, you can see the wonderful strengths associated with them, but please be humble enough to recognize that with each one of those strengths, there are some potential blind spots that you're going to have to deal with in order to effectively lead change. You don't effectively lead change just because you want to. Change is too hard. There's too many variables why people don't want to go. And if you can do a good job of thinking about yourself and what you're doing or not doing in leading change, the odds of you getting there go in your favor. All right, so one last time, which one of these are you? My bottom line to you, it doesn't matter. They're all cool. Don't for one minute think one is better than the other, because they are not. I don't care which one of the 34 you are, you could effectively lead change. I also don't care which one of you are, of those 34. If you're not careful, those blind spots will be your downfall in leading change. Again, it's kind of your choice. It's kind of your choice as to which it's going to be. So an executor gets things done. Can I get things done through other people? If you're leading change, you want to be good at getting things done through other people. If you're a strategic thinker, it's good to know where you're going and why you're going there, but you better be engaging, involving others. If you're a relationship builder, it's cool that relationships are important to you, but you better make sure that there's accountability built into those relationships, or you will get eaten alive. If you're good at influencing others, you could be very convincing, very inspirational to others, but you better make sure you're producing the results to go along with those. So again, all of us fall into one of those four categories. There might be a couple categories that tend to be our lead categories, but that is, I think, a pretty succinct review of each of those four categories. All right, we talked this morning about a leadership gap. Again, we all know where we're going. We all know what our intentions are, but sometimes our actual behaviors are different than what we intend to do. And that creates what I call, that creates what I call a leadership gap. And if you're effectively leading change, it's because you figured out how to narrow your gap. And if you're struggling with leading change, my promise to you is this: your gap's pretty wide. And what you're intending to do versus what people are actually seeing you do are going to be two different things. And what can you do about that? So I believe during periods of change, our strengths intensify, our blind spots can become more apparent. Our leadership gap potentially can actually get wider as opposed to the opposite. Our leadership effectiveness often can go down. All right, so I talked this morning about, okay, if you want to do something about this, if this is something that is of interest to you for whatever reason, yeah, I want to effectively lead change. My coaching to you is, let's start by thinking about getting 1% better tomorrow than you are today. I hope that you heard something this morning or this afternoon, or you will hear something this afternoon, that you can say to yourself, yeah, I would like to get 1% better. And again, can you get yourself in the land of not only how you see it, but can you develop double vision? Can you take the time to understand that people might see things different about you than you see about yourself? All right, so what can you do? How do you start being a 1% more effective leader? First of all, regardless of your job title in this room, recognize, acknowledge, you are a leader. You are a leader. It's not going away. Embrace it. Get on board with it. Understand that whatever things you do or say, people are going to be influenced by that, and that by definition creates leadership for you. Have the courage to utilize your strengths. Have the humility to recognize those blind spots are real. If you don't believe me, ask somebody close to you about your blind spots and see if they are in a position where they will share those with you. I'm always looking for these quotes. This is a good one. You've probably seen it before. You're not going to remember one thing I said today. You're not going to remember one thing I said today tomorrow. You're just not. Got too many other things going on. But you will remember in some way, shape, or form how I made you feel. Did I challenge you? Did you agree with me? Did you disagree? Were you bought in? Did you think it was a waste of time? All of us tomorrow will only remember how I made you feel. And that's the same with you from a leadership perspective. So you can say all these great things and do all these great things, but people will only remember you for how you feel. What a great opportunity to lead change knowing that that's the case. What else can you do? Loyalty, trust, relationships need to be updated, cared for, maintained. Man, there's a lot of things I'm good at. Building relationships is not necessarily one of them. Again, we talked about relationship builder, but being able to create those relationships, be able to have people trust you, create some of that loyalty, caring about other people, some of those things that we talked about in that serving. You can be doing those, and you can be doing those right now. When people talk to you, you want them to walk away and say, that guy, that gal is the real deal. That guy, that gal is the real deal. And you get to create that. No matter what you've done or not done up until this moment, starting tomorrow, you can create a positive approach towards that question. Are you the real deal? Can people trust you? Can they be loyal to you? Do you care about them? Generate an environment of we, contribute to it, makes sense. Encourage others to be leaders. All right. I need a volunteer. I was wishing Brady was here. Andy, do you mind volunteering with me?
I can volunteer.
Okay. All right.
Do I need to stand first?
You do need to stand. We're going to sit down here in just a moment. All right, so what else can you do to create an environment of I'm a positive living example for leading change? With Andy's help, I'm going to demonstrate a little activity that I think might help you understand something that each of you can be doing as a part of effectively leading change. Why don't you have a seat on the floor? All right, so Andy, what I want to do is I want to figure out a way where we can help each other up.
Okay.
Because no matter what, when we're leading change, there's always going to be time periods where either you're going to be down, I'm going to be down. And again, if we're going to effectively lead change, we need to be able to keep an eye out for each other and make sure that we're all not only helping each other up, but helping those around us up as well. So again, symbolically, I want to see if we can figure out a way where we can help each other up. Here's my boundaries. Neither one of us can get hurt. Now, this is pretty hard floor. So again, you can see there's some built-in dangers, just as there is in the workplace, with being able to not make sure we don't get hurt. So we got to keep an eye on that floor, okay?
Okay.
All right, so let's start figuring out. Let's go like this.
Feet together and
put your hands, why don't you go like that? What do you think about that? I mean, do you worry about wrists or fingers if we try to help each other up that way?
Yeah, I think we're both good.
I'm going to suggest maybe we could do something a little stronger. How about we...
Okay.
What do you think about that?
Feel stronger.
Does that feel a little stronger?
I guess I'm just a risk taker.
Oh, did you get that? He's a risk taker. That's pretty good.
He's also a rock climber.
Oh, no. I wish I would have known that before. All right. So this feels a little safer for me. Because I've done this before, why don't you put your toes just a little bit on mine? Yeah, not too much. But I think that's good.
All right.
And again, what I'm going to suggest is on the count of three, I'm going to look you in the eye, you look me in the eye, I'm going to pull, you pull, and we'll kind of lift at the same time.
Sounds good.
And I'll see if we can help each other up. Now, here's the deal. There's 24 people right now watching us, and 23 of them are saying, I hope they don't do it. They're going, you know, if they fall, this is going to defeat Dennis's purpose. I'd like to see him not be successful. Mm-hmm. Now, maybe the number 23 is a little high because these are all good people and they're certainly protective of you. But have you noticed that all 24 of them are still sitting at their chair, even though you and I are about to embark upon something that's a little scary and we got a hard cement floor that we might tumble on? Mm-hmm. Doesn't that seem a little weird to you?
Friends like these.
Yeah, with friends like these. I was kind of thinking the same way. I don't know them that well, but they're your friends, not mine. So what I was hoping, and I'd start with Big Jim, because if we're going to fall, I'd just soon fall on Big Jim, that maybe he could come around over here and kind of spot us or keep an eye on us. What do you think about that? Do you know Jim at all?
Well, we've met.
Okay.
So I trust him.
All right. I trust him. I've known him a long time. So Jim, why don't you come over here? Now, Jim's a big guy, but this is a lot of space that we're going to fall upon. Do you think there might be some other people around here that might symbolically be willing to come over here?
No, thank you.
Whoa, that is sweet. That's amazing. Pat, it doesn't surprise me at all that you're over here.
89
team?
You're on your own.
So I feel real good about this side. That side's looking scary. We got a table on that side. What do you think? You willing to try it, or should we see if anybody wants to help each other up? All right. Good job.
Do I have to be on your side?
You have to be on Andy's side.
I don't know. I think we're good.
All
you're
right.
Protected.
I have faith in our ability.
All right. Thank you very much. Yeah, now we get it.
All right.
This group is a little slow, but they're powerful. All right. I feel a lot better than I did just a couple minutes ago. How about you?
Yeah, I'm feeling good.
All right, cool. All
right. Ready?
So help each other up. On the count of three, I'm going to pull. You're going to pull. We're going to kind of lift up. We got a lot of help and support around us. And let's see if we can help each other up. One, two, three.
We can do it.
All right. All right. Thank you.
Now, wait a minute, Erin. She goes, that's just like the library system. Two people are doing all the work and everybody else is watching. I would have never said that myself. But wasn't it interesting how long it took for people to get out of their chair and help each other up? And I got some bad news for you. That's often how it works in the workplace as well. And if you want to effectively lead change, if you really want to be one of those positive living examples that we talked about a moment ago, get your rear out of the chair, keep your eyes open, and go help other people up. Because when there's change going on, I promise you, there are opportunities galore to help people up. And I tell you what, that's a powerful message. Symbolically, you should never forget that message again. Because again, it felt a lot better for both of us knowing that if we failed, if we were going to fall over, there were going to be people there to catch us.
Or go down with you.
Or go down with you. Could, I guess that's possible.
When you started that thing, like, you knew what you were doing, and it seemed like, okay, this is going to be fine, and then you started getting, like, gosh, nobody's helping us out. But if you don't ask for help, you can't expect people to just
okay, automatically join in. I think that's a fair assessment. Mm-hmm. However, how many of us as leaders are very good at acknowledging to our friends and peers that I need help? Some of us probably better than others. But I would suggest most of us, especially in leadership positions, especially leading change, that for some reason we think it's kind of a downfall for us to ask for help. Erin, good for you if that's not something that's going to be difficult for you.
It should be something we should be working toward, right?
I'm hoping after today, when Colleen sends me the check for coming up here, she's going to say to herself, yeah, you know what? This organization, whether you're in North San Pete, St. George, or anywhere else in this great state of Utah, that you got somebody that's going to help you up. Because there will be a time you are going to need it. I promise you. I'm going to play you a little bit of music. And I want you to pay attention to the words on this song. The words on the left are the actual words of the group, the New Radicals. The words on the right are my interpretation of those words. And let's see if we can figure out how this applies to effectively leading change. Please pay attention. Where's Matt when we need him?
Everybody's got a copy? Thank you.
So I think you're starting to get a sense of what this session this afternoon is all about. You only get what you give. You get the opportunity to make some choices about how you're effectively going to lead change. Are you going to be that positive leading example? Are you going to be that no way person? Are you going to have the courage to follow your strengths? But are you also going to have the humility to understand those blind spots are real? They are real. They're not going away. In all aspects of your life, even if you don't buy into any of this with respect to work, remember what we talked about before. You were brainstorming the vision of what your personal life was going to be like 5 years from today. These exact same attributes will lead you there just like they do at work. And I would hope you would join me and be a new radical. Be a new radical. I love being 58 years old and being a radical. And being able to potentially influence each of you as you decide what kind of leader you want to be, where it is you want to go, how you're going to go, how you're going to get there. So what I would like you to do, I just passed out a piece of paper, and on that piece of paper is an opportunity for you to write a couple things down. Focusing on the 1%, I would ask each of you to think about what's something that you've picked up today that might help you start to be more effective, maybe as much as 1% effective tomorrow from a leadership perspective. Take just a couple minutes, write yourself a little note. Nobody's going to see this note. Have the courage to do it.